Good afternoon, students. So this lecture is all about performance appraisal. In the previous, which all topics will be discussed in this lecture? It is what is performance appraisal first, and what is the need of performance appraisal? What are the aims of performance appraisal? And what are the methods involved in performance appraisal? There are two categories, broad categories: traditional methods, and then the modern methods nowadays, which are most commonly used. The comparison between the two categories, we'll be discussing about each type or each method in detail, and what are the effective management, how does an effective management of performance appraisal can be done by the end of the lecture. So first and foremost, what is performance appraisal? So it is the process, according to Nordstrom, it is the process of evaluating the performance of employees. So name itself, performance appraisal. First and foremost, you first evaluate. We also call it performance evaluation. You evaluate the performance of the employees. You compare their standard performance with their current performance, whether they are meeting the criteria set by the organization to meet that particular standard performance, which is handed over to them at the joining itself. Okay, the job profile and their expectations are already mentioned at their appointment letter itself. So you compare their current performance with their standard performance, which is being they are expected to perform, and then sharing that information with them. You provide your feedback with them and searching for ways to improve their performance. In the previous lecture, we discussed about training and development. So during staffing, one of the process of staffing is training and development programs, which are generally organized by the human resource HR department to improve the competence or the performance of their employees. So in this performance appraisal category, we'll be evaluating the performance and then sharing the information, which means the feedback to the employee himself also, or to the maybe the higher, the one sitting at the top of the hierarchy or the authorities, which will be further planning the appraisal. So performance appraisal, in a more detailed way, it is the step where the management finds out how effective it has been at hiring and placing employees. So let's just talk about one employee. The management decides that how effective it has been. The decision of recruiting that employee was a good one or a bad one. So a performance appraisal is the process of evaluating an employee's performance of a job in terms of its requirement. The decision which was taken during staffing was supported or not. Then what is the need of performance evaluations? Why do you need performance evaluations or performance appraisals? First, performance needs to be evaluated. Why? Because it provides a review of past work performance. So some organization prefers to do performance evaluations once in a year. Others prefer to do it every 3 months. Some other prefers to do it every 6 months. So, for example, the organizations which are doing performance evaluations, let's just say 6 months. So they'll be evaluating the performance of the employee from in this past 6 months duration. So it helps us to review. It helps the management to review the past work performance. Then establish the lines of communication. By work evaluations, performance evaluations, you are communicating with the employee. And an organization may have a huge or the great numbers of employee. It is sometimes become difficult to communicate with each and every employee. So during these performance evaluations or appraisal tasks, you get to communicate with the employee as well. That is also one of the advantage. Then it creates an opportunity to discuss professional development goals and objectives. So being a physiotherapist, let's just say when you and you're working as a physiotherapist in a hospital, you during those 6 months of your performance evaluations, you have attended various workshops, you were involved in various training and developmental programs. So during your performance evaluation, now you discuss that whatever you have achieved during 6 months outside the hospital premises as well and inside the hospital premises as well. So you get the opportunity, you create an opportunity to discuss your goals and objectives as well. Then document performance, employee's performance, that's for sure. And document corrective action necessary to the work performance. Let's just say that one employee is being found to be not working up to the standard performance. Now, human resource department plans a training and developmental training schedule. So it provides the opportunity for them to improve the competence levels of the employees. So it is the supervisor's and manager's responsibility to monitor, evaluate and coach employees. Like you have to assess the performance of your subordinate. Similarly, the management task or the human resource, the HR department, it is mentioned in their job profile, it is part of their job profile to monitor, evaluate and coach their subordinates or the other employees. It's a modern method. Now, next is aims of performance appraisal. What are the aims? What are you directing yourself? What are the aims and objectives? So first is that with performance appraisal, you will get employee feedback. Then second is you identify employee training need. If there's any need to plan the training and developmental program or not, because only on based on these performance evaluations you get to know, you find out the need. Then document the criteria of performance evaluation. The documentation criteria or the criteria for performance evaluations are usually kept anonymous by some organizations, and others prefers to tell the employees beforehand only. That we will be discussing during when we will be discussing about the methods of performance appraisal. Now form a basis for personnel, like for example salary increases, matlab the bonuses, the hikes, then the promotions, demotions, the disciplinary action if that's required or not, bonuses, etc. Those decisions are taken by the management based on your performance evaluations only. Then provide the opportunity for organizational diagnosis and development. You get to review your workplace during the time of performance evaluations, that everything is streamlined or not, or if there's any other extra effort which is required for streamlining. So, or what else can be done to improve the competence levels of the employee. It, as we have discussed, it facilitates communication between the employer and the employee, or between the management and the employee, that whether the expectations set by the employee and the employer are met with each other or not. Okay, and then validate selection criteria, selection techniques and human resource policies. As we've discussed, during selection only, recruitment and selection, you select the candidate which fit perfectly with the job. Whether that selection technique is justified with, if you have selected the right employee for the right job or not, that is also validated through this. Now provide information to assist in the HR decisions. We've discussed promotion, transfer. It provides clarity of expectation and responsibility of the functions to be performed by the employees. You restate to the employees that what is expected of them, to judge the effectiveness of the other human resource functions, to reduce the grievances of the employees. When you communicate with the employees, you get to know about their grievances, their expectations from the employer, their expectations from the management, and what is those factors which are impeding for them to work in the more in the best possible way. It helps in strengthening the relationship and communication between the superior and subordinates and the management. Then these are the methods which I was talking about. Methods. There are two broad categories for the methods which are commonly used for performance appraisal. Traditional methods, which were practiced earlier. Some organization still stick to the traditional methods. Other prefer modern methods in comparison to the traditional methods. Naming them, traditional methods are straight ranking method, essay appraisal method, paired comparison method, critical incident method, field review, checklist method, graphic rating scale, force distribution. Modern methods include MBO, which is management by objectives, 360 degree method, I've just shown you in the video, then assessment centers, behaviorally anchored rating scale, and human resource accounting method. First is amongst traditional methods, first is essay appraisal method. So this is the traditional form I've discussed. This is one of the traditional methods. It is also known as free form method. Essay appraisal method, free form method. It involves a description of the performance of the employee by his superior. Simply superior judges the performance or evaluates the performance of the employee, just his reporting officer, his reporting authority or the superior, based on his performance. There is nothing more involved in that. That is why it is known as free form method. The major drawback or the major disadvantage of this method is the inseparability of the bias, because here there are tendency or the likability that if your superior has any personal grudges or if because of any other biasing, sometimes they may get victims of such bias. Second method is straight ranking method. Now name also implies here, this is a straight ranking method. Again, it is done by superior only. In this method, what does an appraiser or your superior do is, they rank the employee from the best to the poorest. Matlab your ranking. For example, in a class, like your teacher, what does, on the basis of marks, marks are the criteria based on which the students are ranked. Okay, similarly in the workplace also, in the performance appraisal method, straight ranking method, employee's performance is ranked from best to the poorest, and based on that decisions are taken, like salary, performance appraisals, bonuses or transfers, promotions, demotions, based on this. So this is a straight ranking method. The next is paired comparison. Paired comparison is a better technique in comparison. Why? Because here the chances of bias are also reduced. Then it's a better technique than the straight ranking, because this method, what happens in this method is, for example, there are 5 employees, just to simplify this, whose performance you need to evaluate being their superior or their appraiser. So naming them A, B, C, D, E. So you compare A's performance with B, you pair them. Similarly, you compare A with C, you compare A with D, you compare A with E. So each employee's performance is compared with his group members one by one. Similarly, B's performance is compared with A, B's performance is compared with C, B's performance is compared with D, B's performance is compared with E. So it's a comparative evaluation. That is why it is known as paired comparison. Next is checklist method. In checklist method, what happens? You know what is checklist? So in this method, the rater is given a checklist of the descriptions. Let's just say, for example, the punctuality of the employee, the targets met with by the employee, whether or he or she was in the defaulter list, okay, whether he met the standard performance or not. So there are certain categories which are built, and the superior or the appraiser has to fill the performance of the employee on that checklist. Okay, so checklist method. Then another is critical incident method. In critical incident method, what happens is that appraisal, the evaluator rates the employee on the basis of critical events or how the employee behaved during those incidents. For example, you've been asked, like as a student, if I tell you to submit me 5 assignments, I give you 5 topics to submit in next 1 hour. So what will happen? It is a difficult task to accomplish. So it's a critical incident. Okay. And then you assess the behavior. As a teacher, I'll assess your behavior during that 1 hour. That were you able to do it? Or if you, yes, you did it, you freaked out, you, what happened? So for that, evaluator create critical incidents, and then what does they do? They evaluate the performance of employees during those critical incidents, and based on that, their performance is judged. Next method is field review. Field review, in this method, a senior member of HR, okay, department, or a training officer discussing with the supervisor. Till now we've discussed the supervisor, your senior, your superior was evaluating the performance. In this method, a senior person from the HR sits with your superior, and then they discuss each and every employee one by one their performances. So it's a field review. Next is graphing rating scale. Graphing rating scale is comparatively a better method. In this method, an employee's quality and quantity of work is assessed in a graphing scale indicating different degrees of particular trait. For example, the factors taken into the consideration include both personal characteristics and characteristics related on the job performance. For example, a trait like job knowledge may be judged on the basis of average, above average, outstanding, or unsatisfactory. So, like in the checklist method, you created some traits. So, here also you create a trait, for example, knowledge. Okay, now you draw a graph and place that particular, for that employee, you place him into the category of average, above average, outstanding, or unsatisfactory. On a graph, you have already drawn a graph. Average, above average, outstanding, unsatisfactory. For that employee, you make it. Next is force distribution. Force distribution means placing, for example, placing an employee into one such category like average, above average, outstanding, unsatisfactory performance. You are forcefully creating a category and putting them there. Okay, so that is force distribution. The rater chooses the appropriate fit for the category on his own discretion. Now, next is the modern methods of performance appraisal. First is assessment centers. So, nowadays assessment centers, this method is widely practiced. An assessment center typically involves the use of methods like social or informal events, tests or exercises, assignments. Like for example, you have scheduled a surprise assignment for all your employees based on their field of expertise, and then these tests, these assignments, these quizzes, they are used as for their performance evaluation. In behaviorally anchored rating scales, which is the second method of performance appraisal, behaviorally anchored rating scales name is suggestive of something like your behavior will be interpreted. So is a relatively new technique which combines graphing rating scale and critical incident method. Now we've just now discussed graphic rating scales means, which was to put somebody into the category, draw a graph, above average, average, unsatisfactory, satisfactory, like those categories. It combines graphic rating scale with the critical incident method. You create critical incident episodes and then you determine or judge the behavior of employees during those times of critical incidents. So it combines both of these techniques. Third is human resource accounting method. So basically this is also one of the methods which is most adopted nowadays. So what does they do is, during your process of staffing, like after manpower planning, we have discussed in previous lecture, during recruitment and selection, what was there? Let's just take a review. During recruitment, first after manpower planning or requirement, you have reviewed your current workplace and found out that for your new project, 5 new people will be required. Okay, 5 new software developers will be required. Okay, what should be the qualifications for the same, that is predetermined, and then you advertise through newspaper, social media and various other platforms based on any other channel of your preference. And then applications are invited, and in the process of selection you choose those 5 candidates amongst all which fits into that job the most. Okay, so during human resource accounting method, human resource, what does they do is, the cost of employees, including the expenses incurred on them, like compensation, like from the past 6 months, what is compensation which is being given to them, what was the cost of recruitment, what was the cost of selection, what was the cost of induction or orientation program which was done, what was the cost of training which was scheduled for them particularly, etc., is compared with their contribution indeed total value added. For example, if you are in a sales department, you are being given with the target to do a sale of, let's just say, 2 lakh rupees by the end of 2 months. So whether have you met that target or not, in comparison, that is met is compared with the cost which the organization has bear on you for providing you with the remuneration, with the compensation for the training and development. That is compared, and then the HR decides whether they want to continue with the services of that particular employee in future or not. That is human resource accounting method. 360 degree performance appraisal method we have already discussed. So it generally has four integral components. We've already discussed that it's a common developmental tool. 360 degree feedback, it's a multi-rater feedback. So it generally has four integral components like self-appraisal, superiors appraisal, subordinates appraisal, and peer appraisal. Sometimes other people like your contributors, your stakeholders, their opinion or their viewpoint is also taken into consideration along with this. So there's a flexibility there. Generally 6 to 8 raters feedback is usually evaluated for 360 degree performance. Why is it called 360 degree performance? Because it's a holistic review method, appraisal method. So also, and it takes it, the feedback is taken around from the people around you whom you interact the most, knowingly or next method is management by objectives. It is usually done, it's a strategic management model that aims to involve the performance of an organization by clearly defining objectives. So what happens in this one is, okay, let me just give you an example first, then we'll discuss. So the one which I was talking about, say, let's just say your organization has told you to do the sales of 1 crore rupee in a year. Okay, so once you listen to it, like 1 crore rupee in a year will be a tough task to achieve. So what happens is that management or the organization, people representing the organization and an employee, both sits together, and then they break the task into short. The objectives are set in a cascade manner. In a cascade manner means they set short-term objectives in order to achieve that long-term goal. So in order to achieve that 1 crore target or 1 lakh target in a month, what happens is that 50,000 target is set after every 15 days. So that's like a cascade of objective which is being set. So here you can see that define organizational goals. Organization defines its goal. Okay, then define employee's objective. Employee's objectives and his goals are both decided. They both sit together and then they decide. Then continuous monitoring. During this, after that, the employee sets in and starts working in the direction of achieving the objective, and his performance is continuously monitored. Performance evaluation, then providing feedback. Lekin the difference here is that it's in the cascade manner. The objectives are cascade, which means once you achieve one objective, another objective is set at the same time when you finish the earlier one. So for the MBO to be successful, okay, it was given by Guru Peter Drucker in his 1954 book, The Practice of Management. What does it aim for? It improves the performance of an organization by clearly defining objectives that are agreed to by both management employees. Like I said, both management employees, they both sit together. They clearly define their objectives and goals. Okay. Now for it to be successful, top management must be committed. It must be applied organization-wide. Matlab, it can't be given to one employee. This whole team, this whole organization who is working in the similar manner. And objective must be cascade. Cascade means one after the other. It is a personal management technique where managers and employees work together to set, record and monitor goals of a specified period. So these are certain practice questions, and here are your references. Thank you.